Legs should feel a lot better.
How they're breathing?
Try one good then.
I would say use your knee. I feel like they get more
pressure.
Yeah, that's fine. You can use your elbow. If you want to get really kind of deep, you can even really split that.
Yeah, that one. I feel that one.
So you can lower as well, yeah?
Yeah, I'll do it all the way along the hammock. Here's a strong technique, so you could... And then there's body moves.
Oh, that's in the car. Go straight into the car.
What was the car? Oh, press into the middle. And then I've got this car break. Into the middle of the car.
Too much.
My car's already jammed.
It's good.
Bit more. Yeah.
That's
it.
Need more weight?
Anyone with any questions? You're a bit worn out.
Are we going to have a big seat?
I'm
like,
good outcome.
Got a bit more on that one.
Huh?
A bit more on that one.
No, just keep the elbow in. If you want to put pressure, it's best to be on the closest side to you.
Do the stand down.
You're going to feel it, man.
That's it.
Guys, gents, we've got kind of 15 minutes to go, and there's a lot of stuff that we haven't covered yet. So is there anything in particular in the last 15 minutes? I know you guys are worn out, you've been going full on for 2 hours. 2 hours of treatment is a long time. You earn my job, you can
make all the money. Yeah.
So, okay, so Buddy, if you, if I get you to lie down for me. So, so it's the same for quads, it's active release therapy. You would put pressure. The function of the quads is to extend the leg, to do extension of the knee, like that. So in order to get them to move the leg, you wouldn't be able to do it in this position, but you could get, without getting them to tense the leg, you could still release the leg. So you put pressure down onto the quad as much as they can kind of tolerate, and then you just come off. So this is pretty much, this is mainly for the guys with overdeveloped quads. They tend to get a lot of pain and stiffness in the quads, and it can be quite difficult then to sit. So this can be really handy if you've been sitting for a while and your quads are starting to go into spasm. Really useful. Then for knee pain, which is one area that we were going to cover, and ankle pain for body. Knee pain, quads are the most important element for knee pain. So if you work into the quads, you can do it with the knuckles. So same technique, rolfing technique this time. Applying pressure into the quads. So you've got the, we call the ASIS, the front of the pelvis here. And then if you go below that, you've got muscle here. You don't want to go too much towards the middle because that can be a bit uncomfortable. So in the top part, we go on the outer part of the thigh. As we get to the middle of the quad muscle, we go more into the center. And then we don't press into the knee, we just go above the knee. So we're going to do that now. We're going to work into pressure points for knee pain. So we're going to go at the top. Here's the bone where the pelvis is. Put hand width down from there. Apply pressure straight down as much as the person can tolerate. So that's about as much as I can do because I'm not strong enough for Baji here. And then you'd release 30 seconds, come into the middle part of the quad. Do the same there. If that's not enough pressure, you can use your knee. And then here's the knee joint. You go above, kind of hand width above that, and you do the same above the knee. So we're working to trigger points for the quadricep. Or pressure points for the quadricep. This is brilliant for knee pain. The other question about knee pains was, what do you do if you've got a knee which keeps clicking? Knees usually click. The most common complaint for knees is clicking of the knees and also the ankles. And knees click because of usually because of the tracking of the patella. It's not because you have arthritis in the knee or anything like that. It's because this bone, it's a force transmitter across the leg. And sometimes when you go from standing or squatting position, that those tendons and that bone moves out of place, and that gives you that clicking or cracking sensation in the knee. The only way to really get rid of that is through strengthening up the legs. The stronger the legs get, the more control there is over the tracking of the patella. And this muscle here, which you can kind of see, is like a teardrop muscle. Vastus medialis is really important in terms of controlling that patella, and that reduces clicking and popping a lot. So the number one thing to do for knee pain is strengthen up the quadriceps. And the best way to do that is things like swimming. But also if you're into weightlifting, you can do things like box squats or leg extensions are really important for building this. And that will reduce that clicking and also get rid of pain in that area. So usually with my knee pain patients, I get them all in the pool. And that normally fixes the knee problem, whether it's patella tendonitis or runner's knee, patellofemoral pain syndrome, which is that kind of rubbing of this bone against the knee. So all of these issues can be fixed by strengthening the knee. So if you can't get access to a pool, if you can't get access to a gym, I'll show you a couple of exercises for knees. So this is my favorite actually, because it builds core stability and the knees as well. So keeping the knees together, keeping the knees and ankles together, hands relaxed by the side. If I get you to do a leg raise, so lift up legs to 90 degrees, both legs. So we're gonna challenge body now, because this isn't easy to do. Up to 90 degrees and then back down again. And we do 50 of those. So.
There we go.
Up to 90 degrees. That's it. And then back down again. So we're putting the hamstring on a bit of a stretch at the same time. You can see how those quads are contracting. So that means that muscle is working. And that's what we want to do. We want to get balance in between that quad. We want to work both sides symmetrically. And then also when we're doing both legs, we're activating the core quite a lot. So you'll see his stomach come out a little bit as he brings up his knees, which means that those muscles are being worked at the same time, so that's hard. So we're building that whole kind of anterior chain, which is really important. So Karen, please. 47 left, 46 left. No, that's brilliant. Okay, and relax. So leg raises, number one exercise for kind of getting rid of tapping and popping in the knees, and also knee pain. If you have a pathology like a meniscus tear, then it's a bit different, or ACL tear. So there's a disc in the knee, a cartilage in the knee. If that tears, if it's the inside part of the cartilage, that has a better blood flow, so that can get better on its own. If it's the outside part, generally that doesn't have a great blood flow, so it doesn't generally get better on its own and needs some surgery. So they would normally go in, as they did with Baji, they would put a camera in there and they'd normally stitch it up, or they would shave away on the meniscus that's sticking out or that's damaged. Often that doesn't work, and then they need to go in again and again. And sometimes they'll actually remove the meniscus, or if the knee's really bad, they'll just remove the joint and put an artificial joint in there, what they call a total knee replacement. So those are kind of some of the options. But the main thing is there's a lot that you can do through physical rehabilitation, through swimming, through exercise, through building up the quad strength so that you don't get any knee pain and you don't need to explore those other options. Because once you have surgery and it fails, it's kind of a cycle of getting it again and it failing again and getting it again and failing again. So the most important thing is the rehab, is the stuff that you can do. And this brings me on to a point of kind of the locus of control. With our community, the locus of control is often with the doctor. We think we go to them, they're going to give us a pill, and then we'll get fixed, and we don't need to do anything ourselves. But most of the things we need to do are in our own control. So it's lifestyle factors. So they can help with symptoms in terms of pain relief and things like that. But there's a lot that we need to do ourselves in order to kind of address the problem long term. So it's about getting the right advice and then implementing it. So when I talked about my lower back patients, and how nearly all of them so far have gotten better, it's because I've told them what to do and they've done it. And that's partly because I work with people who are sports people, so they're very motivated, they're very kind of enthusiastic to get back to sport, and they would kind of do anything you tell them to do. But exercise is kind of a fundamental element to getting back to pain, being in a pain-free state. So now most people nowadays are in pain. They've either got neck pain, knee pain, back pain, some kind of pain. And that's an indication that something's going wrong in our lifestyles or in our life, because that shouldn't be our default state, shouldn't be to be in pain. So we really, really need to invest time and address those issues. So releasing off calves, you use the knee or use the fist. We'll get rid of some knee pain for you guys today. Another way to do this is if I get you to come onto your back front for me, so flip around. Try this one out as well. This is an MET. You need to be a little bit more careful with this one. If you're working with an elderly person and they've got a lot of arthritis in the knee, it'll get to about here, and then you'll feel like it doesn't really go any further, and it's painful for them. So you need to be a bit more careful. So you'd go as far back as the leg comfortably goes. For Baji, it goes to about there, and that's where I'm getting resistance. So I'd get him to push against me for 3 seconds, and that's great because he's not using much force, otherwise I'd go flying, and then relax, deep breath in, and breathe out, and then I can bring that leg closer towards his glute, as far as it's comfortable, and this is again working on that quadricep muscle, and push against me again, and relax. If you've got knee pain, you should find an immediate benefit with both of these exercises, with both of these techniques. So you do that twice. And then you can switch over to the other knee and get some balance. Or you could just leave one side so they know what it feels like to have it done and not have it done. So have a go of that. Let's work on knee pain and then we'll move on. So you guys are doing really well. A little while longer to go. So 5 more minutes.
Straight onto the exercise that you showed us.
Straight onto the knee pain stuff. So using the release for the quad. And then once you've tried that, do the MET for the quad, which is them lying face down and you pull the leg towards the bottom. Yep, how about that?
Can you have that second one?
Yeah. Yeah.
Is that safe to do? Yeah. My patella slipped up.
Yeah, I wouldn't do it.
No?
Yeah.
Okay, and because mine, what the problem is, my ligament on this side pulls the knee to the stretch.
Yeah.
Loose on that side.
Yeah.
And the groove underneath is flat.
Yeah.
So what can I do?
Treatment,
they want me to have an operation to follow my respect and the groove, make the groove.
But that's not a new operation. Yeah, it's not that really good way to go. Because most of the problem is that they're crazy, you might double your pot size.
When you stand up, I'm like, you know, just get them to push off.
Try this.
This made me cry though, eh?
Stop.
Ready? Just breathe. Take a breath. This feels so good when you went after I get off.
Did you try and do that?
No, I couldn't.
That was well good.
do the shoot.
So with this, just...
This is how
push against me.
Okay, brilliant. So we're gonna finish now. Wadi asked a question about ankle pain. Ankle pain, once you twisted your ankle once, you're actually quite likely, so there's about 30% chance that you're gonna twist it within the next 2 weeks after having an ankle sprain again. So the reason is because when you tear or strain the ligament, you mess up the mind-body connection with that area. And that's why it's really important to get the proper rehab, otherwise you'll keep doing it again and again. When you get an injury to an area, you end up with some swelling. So Baji's complaining of a swollen ankle that's been there for over a year. Swelling is very stubborn. It takes a very long time to build. Sometimes it can take years. The best thing you can do for that is hydrotherapy, which is cold, basically applying some cold compressed to the area, and that will get rid of the swelling. But you need to build up the ankle. So wobble boards are the number one best thing to use. It's a round piece of wood and has half a ball at the bottom of it. It's a bit like a tennis ball, cut in half, and then there's a platform on top of the tennis ball, and then you stand on it. And as you stand on it, you're kind of going all over the place, falling over. But over time, your balance builds, and you're able to stand on it for longer and longer. And as you do that, your mind-body connection improves as well. And I used to do Thai boxing, and what I found was when I'd spend time on the wobble board, it was a lot harder to be taken down in Thai boxing. So if somebody leg kicked me or trapped and caught a leg, my stability was a lot better and I used to go down a lot less. So that was even without an injury. If you have an injury, you're much less likely to re-injure that ankle by going over on the ankle. We call it an inversion ankle sprain, which is how most ankle sprains happen. We're running or we're doing some kind of sport, or we step off a curve and our ankle goes like that, and we end up in pain on the outside of the ankle around the front, and we end up in swelling of the ankle. So the way to build that up usually would be to ice it in the immediate, so it's rest, ice, compression and elevation. So we'd ice it, rest it, we could use an anklet, and then when we're not using the ankle, we could raise it up. So if we're lying on the sofa, we could put our foot on the armrest to get some of the drainage, to get some of the swelling back down to the heart, to get rid of some of the swelling. Once that initial phase has gone after the first 2 weeks, then we'd start to build back strength into the ankle, start to walk normally, start to exercise, start to skip, start to run on it, and work on proprioception at the same time. So with rehabbing an area, you can do things like these kind of techniques that we've seen, but these are more for chronic types of issues. For an acute type of injury like that, it's about managing it, which is usually rest, ice, compression, and you can't elevate some areas like the lower back or neck. So if it's a limb like an arm or a leg, you can elevate that. So it's usually rest, ice, compression.
I heard what you're saying. What about, you know, doctors normally say if you sprain it to take ibuprofen, what would you suggest about that?
Yeah, so there's conflicting research on the use of ibuprofen because it can delay healing of tissues. So it can have an opposite effect. Although it helps with pain, it can impede tissue recovery and increase tissue healing time. So you're better off icing it because you're going to have the same pain-killing effects without kind of systemically reducing inflammation in the body. So we saw a lot of manipulations earlier, and ibuprofen is actually a quite a risky drug, although we take it like it's not. If we read the cautions, there's actually a number of deaths through taking ibuprofen per year because it does block something in the body which protects the gut, and you can get peptic ulcers, you can get bleeding ulcers in the stomach, and then you can get complications as a result for that. So these types of medications like naproxen, ibuprofen, or the whole anti-NSAID, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory family, aren't something that we want to take on a regular basis. If we have an acute injury, we might take some painkillers to help us to stay mobile, but it's not something that, like with the I see with people in my clinic, you want to take just to manage pain on an ongoing basis, because they could have some complications with that. So it's better to address the issue, look at the underlying factors, the causes, and what things there are in your lifestyle that are contributing to maintaining that problem, and trying to address those, as opposed to just popping a pill to keep going and ignoring the problem.
Just a quick question with ankles. Other like kids that play football and stuff, every time they're at ankles, like even when I was a kid, my mum used to get like hot Barney and Dale and Law and put your foot in like hot water. Is it?
Yeah.
Should you use hot water, or should you use, because now they're telling you sort of use like,
So the I think Indians hate cold. I think it's part of the our genetic makeup to hate cold. And I'm in that group. So when, you know, we would say to somebody, if you have an acute injury, especially if it's like ligamentous or joint, put ice on it. If it's muscular, like you have your back is a bit, like, let's say you're doing some manual work, like Bhaji's doing, fitting a boiler or something, his back feeling a bit sore, he might have a hot bath, which would help his back feel a lot better. He's good to go the next day, as opposed to sticking the ice pack on it. So there's kind of conflicting evidence, and what I've found from my clinical experience is that it's different for individuals. So for you, you might respond better from having a hot bath. So if you sprain your ankle having a hot bath and you feel a lot better after that. Hot generally works really well for muscle, and ice usually works better for joints and ligaments. But everyone is individual. I wouldn't say to an elderly person, put an ice pack on, because it's too much of a shock to their nervous system. It just feels horrible for them. Whereas a young guy who's a football player sprains their ankle, I'd probably say, yeah, stick an ice pack on it as much as you can over the next 48 hours. And in 48 hours, you should be a lot better, rather than telling him to put heat on it, which would probably cause more swelling in the ankle because blood would pool in the area and it would probably take him longer to get better. So it doesn't really answer your question.
Would you say that ice pack consistently, or, you know, people say 20 minutes on, 20 minutes off?
Yeah, so the reason to do 20 minutes on, 20 minutes off is because you can get burnt from ice as well. If you put too much ice on, your foot goes numb and or your area that you applied it to goes numb and you keep ice on it, you're not really aware of what's happening to those tissues. So you want to cool them and then allow them to reheat, cool them and allow them to reheat. But what I find generally in practice is that people put ice packs on and then they stick it back in the freezer and it's been like an hour or two before they put it on again. So I would say it's, you can have a break from the ice, but it's a short period of time. I find it particularly with like prolapse discs, slip discs, ice is really beneficial. I usually get people to wear a back belt with one that you can tuck an ice pack into and then have two ice packs on the go. So you put one in the freezer, you've got one on the back belt, and I can usually get people, kind of keep people in work, or usually get back people to back to work or sport quite quickly with the use of ice. Some people ask me, like people who play football, young kids, they ask me about the benefit of ice baths and cold showers. And anyone know of Wim Hof? This kind of, I think he's a guy from Holland. He does some crazy stuff. They call him the Iceman. He's climbed Everest in his boxer shorts and things like that. So he does a lot of stuff around cold. And there is some research to show that it's slightly more beneficial than having a hot bath. But for most people, I would rather have a hot bath than have an ice bath. So even though it may be slightly more beneficial, you've got to look at what's more sustainable. And it's unlikely that you're going to be able to have an ice bath on a weekly basis, or you're going to enjoy that process. So for young kids, post-football match, I'd say in a hot bath, Epsom salts, and they should feel a lot better the next day, a lot less DOMS, which is delayed onset muscle soreness. So I don't know if that answers your question. So it's generally heat, cute spray, and you might put an ice pack on it. Anybody else?
So there's no cold shower in India?
I think in India that's how we used to do it, right? Cold shower, you know, the only time we'd get hot water is in the summer when the pipes would be hot, so the water would be like relatively warm, but otherwise it was always cold showers. I personally take cold showers. I have it warm and then I turn it cold because it has numerous benefits. There's also mental health benefits. It was actually a treatment for depression back in the days. And as well as apnea, who use it, the Japanese use it. They it's a process for them. The samurai, they used to go under waterfalls first thing in the morning. And they used to, the process used to be kind of like killing yourself. So they would do the hardest thing, which was go under cold, freezing cold water first thing in the morning. And they believed if they did that, it was like accepting death for them, that nothing else could faze them if they were able to do that first thing in the morning. So I think it is a practice that a lot of people implement. So I think there's benefit in it, but it's not for everyone. So you just got to build up to it and then see what's right for your body and go along those lines. Don't know if that answers the question. And it is different in different areas. Like, you know, Toronto, I wouldn't want to have a cold shower in Toronto in the winter when it's like minus 40. The UK as well, when it's really cold here, it's going to be hard to get in a cold shower. But other countries, you know, India is also, it doesn't get so bad. I'd say that. Anybody else with any questions? I've had a cold shower in India in the winter, outside. And it's actually good because compared to the atmosphere temperature, the water actually feels warm and you see steam coming out of the water because the water's coming from underground, so the pipes are generally warm, so it's not so bad.
No, it's not good.
Apart from having, Gopal, you've got a different experience for where he had baths, and he stayed in India for a lot longer, so he's got a long experience.
I didn't like it.
Any other questions? So did anyone get any benefit from today? Has everyone left feeling a little bit better? Does anyone remember any of the techniques that they've learnt? Did you go home and practice them? Friends and family and spouses? Yeah. Is time worthwhile?
Yeah.
So thank you very much for your time and attention. If you do have any feedback, please give it to me or please give it to Baji. He doesn't have to tell me who left it if you say anything bad. But it'd be really nice to get your feedback so that I can improve for future seminars and try and make them better and better for the Sangha. So thank you very much for your time and attention. Please forgive any mistakes over the last 2 hours. If anyone's got time to make a little video for testimonials?
Yeah,
if anyone wants to make a video testimonial, that would be really much appreciated. You can just say if you find any benefit in the seminar, and then other people who are reluctant to book on might be more likely to book on in the future. So that would be really handy. And if you do have any requests, because there was a lot to cover in 2 hours, if you do have any requests of any content that you want put up, I can make videos for you and I can send them to you as a private YouTube link, or I can put them up on my Instagram and you can and tag you in them, and you can see, and it can help other people as well who might have similar problems. So do message me or text me any questions that you have, and I'll make a video response based on your question. So please forgive any mistakes.
But we'll be around for a few minutes if everyone wants a quick word while we pack away.
Yeah. Also, please take some sachets of Biofreeze. It's really good. Use it when you're doing any massage. Yeah. If you have any sore spots, put it on there. You'll really like it.